organizers and also welcome our guests as well as everyone who are here to this conference. I think my task here is in a way to complement Fernando's presentation on mobility. And I will talk about mobility in Turkish cities. I have to admit, not specifically on Istanbul, as I live and research predominantly about Ankara. But from time to time, I will also refer, I'll try to give a general overview, but also refer to Istanbul as well. So I'll try to present a picture of mobility in Turkish cities. I'll talk about trends, opportunities, problems, and strategies that the local governments adopt in order to address these problems. But from the beginning, I also want to tell you that the message that I want to convey to you is we have a lot of problems, we have a lot of potentials and opportunities, but we have a mixed performance of adopting effective strategies, and therefore this is a story of missed opportunities in a way. So let me start by talking about trends in land use patterns and spatial structure, because mobility is an outcome of land use patterns. We can say that Turkish cities have tended to grow in a compact manner. Development densities have been high, while travel distances have been relatively low. This is due to the lack of private cars for the majority of people in the past and the absence or late arrival of rapid transit modes, such as urban rail systems or the bus rapid transit systems. And the lack of these result in a reliance on walking and public transport buses, both of which are slower modes, and therefore they reinforce the compactness of the cities. However, this picture has been changing, particularly in metropolitan cities. One of the reasons for change are that in metropolitan cities, demand for travel is very high, and our local governments are investing on rapid transit systems, such as, again, urban rail systems. And these help develop new corridors of growth. So this increases the spatial growth of the cities. But in addition to that, now, although we used to have lower car ownership levels, now car ownership is increasing, consequently car usage is increasing in our cities, and this is resulting in unplanned sprawl as opposed to the planned decentralization through the corridors, urban rail corridors. And this is further reinforced by development of out-of-town shopping centers or decentralization of office areas, creation of new office complexes at the periphery of the cities. And these are changing the compactness to a significant extent. Nevertheless, coming to the transport use and mobility, this traditionally compact and high-density development pattern makes walking an important mode in urban transport. According to 2013 data, 29% of all trips in Ankara were made by walking. And according to 2006 data in Istanbul, 49, so almost half of the trips in Istanbul were made by walking. I'd like you to remember this one in particular, this 50%, because as we could follow in Fernando's presentation too, walking is considered as a sustainable mode of transport. It is an indicator of sustainable mobility. So this is something that I will emphasize as one of the major potentials of the Turkish cities and of Istanbul too. But we will come back to how that 50% walk in reality. Cycling as an urban transport mode is still rare in Turkish cities, but there's a growing interest in bike share programs, so this is changing the picture a little bit. And public transport. We have high shares of public transport in our cities. This 60 to 80% is of all motorized trips. So when we take walking and cycling out of this, when we take non-motorized transport out of this, 60 to 80% of trips in Turkish cities, in metropolitan cities, are made by public transport. But when we are talking about public transport, we also have an important part of public transport as paratransit. This is paratransit services are in the form of minibuses. They are very widespread in metropolitan cities. They have started as an informal service in order to fill the gap when public transport services provided by the municipalities were not adequate to meet the demand. So in a way, they filled in the gap for public transport and they supported public transport. Model share of this paratransit mode, for example, in Ankara, is as high as 31% of all motorized trips. So it is quite an important mode of transport that we have to recognize when looking at Turkish cities, Turkish metropolitan cities. I already mentioned that car ownership is relatively low in comparison to Western European and North American cities. So car use is relatively low. However, the rates of increase are immense. In Ankara, private cars were used in only 18% of all motorized trips in the mid-1990s. Today, this figure is about 38%. So this is a huge increase. So talking of the potentials then, based on these trends, we can emphasize that this high-density or traditionally high-density compact urban form, although this is changing now, makes walking a still viable mode of transport, and this is a major potential. Also, this high share of walking trips is a major potential, and high share of public transport is a major potential. Now I want to go back to that 50% that I asked you to remember, which is this high share of walking trips. So on paper, yes, we can say, if you look at the facts, the statistics, that 50% of people in Istanbul are walking to their destinations, to their jobs. On paper, this looks like a good indicator of sustainable mobility. But again, as you mentioned, mobility is not everything. Is it accessible? What is the quality of that access? What is the safety parameters? Yes, we are walking, but we are walking under these conditions. Parked cars blocking sidewalks. From various cities in Turkey. Also, the capacity of pavements, of sidewalks, are not enough. And we have pedestrian and disabled access hampered by various barriers on these narrow sidewalks, infrastructure or landscape. In city centers, particularly Ankara suffered from this, where pedestrian circulation is the highest, priority is often given to motorized vehicles. So, in fact, pedestrians are marginalized from the transport infrastructure. Sidewalks are narrowed in order to do this, in order to provide more capacity for vehicular traffic, making walking unsafe and inconvenient. Now, continuing with problems in public transport and paratransit, here also we have issues of quality of the accessibility, capacity of the accessibility, and service fragmentation, problems of integration of public transport. Now, we talked about paratransit. In fact, it would be a completely different discussion on its own if we want to talk about paratransit. I will go into the details of that. But they have some very positive service characteristics that are valued by their users, such as the flexibility, perhaps not the speed, but the frequent stops, etc. But at the end, these are smaller vehicles. And in high-demand corridors, they contribute to traffic congestion because of their low carrying capacity. In addition to that, they compete with all other public transport systems. Fare integration and route integration are major challenges for local authorities, because such integration requires agreement of numerous vehicle owners and drivers to sit on the same table and to come to an agreement. Now, integration problem is not only to do with paratransit and public transport, but in fact it exists among almost all public transport modes in many cities. There is a lack of a transit authority in our metropolitan cities, so this is an institutional issue that needs to be addressed. And we have various operators. So we have buses that are operated by the municipality, so they are public buses. But also in our metropolitan cities, we have privately operated buses. On top of these, we have the paratransit modes, also privately operated services. We have urban rail operators that are now, in many cases, operated by a private company or a semi-private company set up by the local governments, and I will mention that too. Now, integration issue is also related with the concept of integrated policymaking. There is definitely a lack of citywide coordinated transport policy that can encourage public transport and discourage the usage of cars, which again you mentioned as the carrots and the sticks policies. Unfortunately, we don't see much policies that are discouraging the usage of private cars in Turkey. So we have these carrot policies for public transport, but not the sticks policies to discourage, to introduce disincentives for car usage. So that brings me to the problems related with automobiles. They're free flowing, they're free parking. By free parking, I'm not only talking about charge, parking charge, that they are freely parking on sidewalks, freely parking on areas that is illegal for them to park, just leaving their cars in the middle of streets, etc. So while car usage is still relatively low in Turkish cities, it is increasing relatively quickly. It is increasing significantly, and therefore traffic congestion has already become a major problem in our metropolitan cities. However, local authorities are extremely reluctant to introduce physical measures or pricing policies in order to restrict car use. So this is not a vote-winning strategy, and they are just trying to avoid anything to restrict car usage. Motorists can park cheaply in central location or park for free on public sidewalks, as I showed you pictures of. And in many cities, we have seen great separated junctions, we have seen tunnels, we have seen flyovers, with a view to accommodate an uninterrupted flow of cars, even in the city center, even in cores, even in central boulevards. The aim is to make the car flow go without stopping. And at the end, this is marginalizing pedestrians and public transport users too. How do we address this strategy, address these problems with strategies? I talked about mixed performance in strategies, but perhaps the most successful, most vigorously implemented, with good results, are the investments on public transport. So almost all local authorities of our metropolitan cities are investing on improving public transport. Here we see the map of Istanbul, and so this line is the bus rapid transit line that is also crossing the Bosphorus, and the other lines are the urban rail system. So a network of rapid transit is developing. Urban rail system, so the BRT in Istanbul is the only example of BRT so far in the Turkish cities, but urban rail systems are being implemented in other cities as well. You see some pictures from Ankara here, some pictures from Istanbul, Izmir, which also has a modern regional rail system, Eskişehir tram system, and some other light rail and tram systems from metropolitan cities. Let me focus on Metrobus just a little bit, the bus rapid transit system in Istanbul. Okay, you see the pictures here, but perhaps this before and after picture is easier to talk about. So the positive aspects of this investment, you can clearly see here with the after picture, there's an order to traffic, but I think more importantly, this picture another message. It gives a message to the users that if they are continuing using their private cars on this corridor, they're going to be stuck in traffic. If they are to choose public transport, the bus rapid transit here, they're going to have a quicker journey. They will have significant time savings. And indeed, they do have significant time savings. So this system is considered as a success in terms of the time savings that it provided to the citizens of Istanbul. Looking at its ridership figures, number of passengers, it is also considered a success. Sometimes it is described as one of the most successful systems, most successful bus rapid transit systems in the world, because it is carrying highest numbers of passengers per kilometer. So again, these are important, but again, these are statistics on paper. So those of you who have used the Metrobus in peak hours know what sort of a journey that you are going through. So it is very successful. It has very high numbers of passengers, yes. And so maybe it's a victim of its success in that sense, of this time savings, that the capacity is not enough, and the vehicle capacity is not enough, the system capacity is not enough, platform, shelter capacities are not enough. Well, before I finish this process, I should say this. This is, in fact, this is my personal inference, that in a way, this is because this system is still not a network. So if you look at Curitiba, which is considered, Curitiba in Brazil, which is considered as one of the pioneers of bus rapid transit, it is a network. This is still just one line. So this system requires other lines to support it and a better integration perhaps with the urban rail systems as well. But I won't go into the details as it will make the presentation very long. So yes, we see intense investment in public transport. Another thing I've already mentioned is these semi-private or quasi-governmental organizations to operate urban rail systems. Now we see these opening in every city, every metropolitan city that runs an urban rail system. These are created for efficiency and profitability of the system, but they are resulting in further fragmentation problems, further integration problems. We have all these different operators and not a transit authority that brings them together. Another area of development is smart transport projects in public transport, in addition to other areas of transport too, but smart cards are increasing, providing many advantages to their users. Smartphone applications also for public transport users, making it a more user-friendly system. But when we look at strategies for non-motorized transport, there is definitely a lack of investment for improving pedestrian access. So I've already mentioned a little bit about this, but this is just showing that 50% of people who are walking, that potential, nobody is seeing them and nobody is trying to provide for that demand. It clearly is a demand, but this is not something that the local governments are very interested in providing. I already mentioned the recent interest in bike share projects. And now let me talk about strategies implemented for car traffic. And I am calling these as conflicting strategies because they're conflicting with everything that is being made to improve public transport services. These are road programs that aim to create a continuous flow of vehicular traffic in the hope that this will relieve traffic congestion. So these tunnels, these grade separated junctions, flyovers, etc., all of these are trying to eliminate signalization in city centers, in central boulevards, and create an uninterrupted flow of traffic. Of course, this is not solving congestion, because as we know, such investments create a very car-oriented transport system and transport infrastructure, and in fact, they attract more car users. Help people who use public transport start using these systems. But in addition to that, they also create an urban environment like this. So dividing the two sides of the boulevard, dividing the activities on the two sides, definitely marginalizing pedestrians, because crossing the two sides are not possible in such investments, and you see further leakages. Now I will conclude. First of all, just summarizing some of the things that I wanted to underline. We see limited investment to improve non-motorized transport, particularly walking, in spite of high share of walking trips. But we see good practice examples of public transport investments. Definitely this is an area that our local governments are adopting strategies for. However, in many cities, these good practice examples for public transport are accompanied by extensive investment in favor of car-based transport. And this is the contradiction, and this is a problem, because urban transport planning and traffic management require a coherent policy framework, which brings policies and projects that complement each other. This is not happening. We do not have coherent policy frameworks that can improve and encourage public transport, cycling, and walking on the one hand, while discouraging the use of private cars. Indeed, we do not see examples of traffic management and travel demand management much in our cities. There are very rare parking management, efficient, effective parking management examples. Therefore, any benefits that we can get from investments in transit and non-motorized transport are likely to be offset if this car-oriented approach in transport network planning and management continues. So, coming to those missed opportunities phrase that I used, now given the existing potentials in transit usage and in walking, and given all the possible positive impacts of all the public transport investments, we can say that we definitely have had an opportunity to create transit-oriented environments and pedestrian-friendly urban environments. But we can now say with some certainty that these are missed opportunities. And finally, I just want to talk in this last slide about possible reasons behind these problems or missed opportunities. Behind these flawed transport policies or the lack of a coherent policy making, there is lack of national urban transport legislation in our country. We don't have an urban transport law. We don't have urban transport guidances. So at the national level, at the central government level, planners, transport planners are well versed in sustainability discourse, but decision makers at the local government level are not that much aware about sustainable mobility. So this information or the information of the discourse at the central government level is not trickling down to the local government. But in addition to that, public awareness is also limited. So there's not always much protest or response, reaction to all these extreme road programs. So also there is a need to educate the public as well, in addition to the decision makers. So if we see this need of a national transport, urban transport law as a need for a top-down approach for education, for increasing awareness, at the same time we need this bottom-up approach with possible awareness-raising campaigns nationwide in order to change this understanding and the discourse of how mobility should be, how accessibility should be, what the quality of access should be, what the citizens should expect from their local government.